us to see. Even if the wants are following, yes, even if the wants are following. Cause I believe everything that you say you are. I believe and I have seen you're a changing heart in the good things and the hardest part. I believe that I will follow you. I believe that I will follow you. When I find myself so far from home, and you leave me somewhere I don't wanna go. Even in my death I follow you. Even in my death I follow you. So when I come to win this race I've run, and I receive the prize that Christ has won, yes, I will be with you.
Good morning. Would you guys stand with us? Join us in worship this morning and sing. He's coming.
He's coming on the clouds. King of kings will bow down. Every chain will break. His broken hearts declare his grace. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is
good morning, Trinity Church. Good to see you guys all here today. Glad you could make it. My name is Monty. Would you join us in a word of prayer as we get started here today? God, thank you so much for the opportunity to worship you together, to lift up your name and sing your praises. That no matter what we're facing, what we're going through, and what the world is throwing at us, that we have the opportunity to live in your peace, to live in your grace, to live in your strength, Lord, that it is not reliant upon us and how we're feeling, but we get to rely on you, our God, our Creator. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Join us as we continue to sing. Now raise a hallelujah. Amen. You guys may be seated. Can we give God a hand for that? That is so true.
So in the midst of singing that song, God gave me scripture, and I love it when he does this because I'm like, okay, God, wherever you're taking me. And he led me directly to Psalm 35, and I want you to hear these words. This is amazing because you know what? That's a bold song to sing. Basically, we're saying that in the middle of the storm, we're going to sing louder and louder. We're going to stand up and we're going to be moving in God's army, and we're going to know that he is going to fight for us. So he led me to Psalm 35, and listen to these words of David. Oh Lord, oppose those who oppose me. Fight those who fight against me. Put on your armor and take up your shield. Prepare for battle and come to my aid. Lift up your spear and javelin against those who pursue me. Let me hear you say, I will give you victory. Bring shame and disgrace on those trying to kill me. Turn them back and humiliate those who want to harm me. Blow them away like chaff in the wind, a wind sent by the angel of the Lord. Make their path dark and slippery with the angel of the Lord pursuing them. I did them no wrong, but they laid a trap for me. I did them no wrong, but they dug a pit to catch me. So let sudden ruin come upon them. Let them be caught up in the trap that they set for me. Let them be destroyed in the pit they dug for me. Then I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be glad because he rescues me. With every bone in my body, I will praise him. Lord, who can compare with you? Who else rescues the helpless from the strong? Who else protects the helpless and poor from those who rob them? Amen. The Lord fights for you today. So in the midst of the storm, you can sing louder and louder. Amen? Amen. We should pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, I am thankful for the armor that you put over us. I'm thankful for your protection. I'm thankful that not only do we pick up our spiritual swords, but also you hold a spiritual spear over us. That, Lord, you are going before us as to clear the way, and you also are our rear guard. Lord, I'm thankful that even though the enemies in our lives, they dig pits for us and traps for us, that you fight for us in the midst of that. Lord, may we not be discouraged this morning. There's already enough to be discouraged about, but may we come to you and know that you fight for us today. So, Lord, whatever it is that we're experiencing, whatever the enemy is in our life, I pray, Lord Jesus, that you defend the righteous, that you defend us today. We thank you for this, and we praise you in your name. Amen. Amen. Such a good word. Such a good word. So I want to share with you, first of all, welcome to everyone here this morning, and also to our guests. If you're a guest with us today, or if you've been here for a while and you haven't had the chance to communicate with the church office or to be able to fill out a connection card, I want to encourage you, in the pew rack in front of you, there is a connection card. Take that out, fill out the information on that card, and then in just a few minutes, we're going to be receiving his tithes and our offerings. And as a guest today, the only thing that we anticipate you putting in the plate is just that card. So again, just want to say a very special welcome to all of you, and we are so glad that you're here with us today. A couple of things that are coming up in the life of the church I want to make you aware of is next Wednesday, or this coming Wednesday, we are going to be in the city of Aurora for our prayer on location. Now, I have to share with you that this past week we were in North Aurora. And if you are not familiar with North Aurora, or if you looked for it or try to find it on a map, it's probably like about this big. It's a slice. It's wedged right between Batavia and Aurora, and we went there with the anticipation that God is going to reveal where it is that we need to go and who it is that we need to meet and to connect with. And I have to tell you that God did not disappoint. God showed up in a mighty and powerful way. In fact, I want to share with you that we met with a young woman named Cher, and it was an incredible encounter with God, and just the things that happened on Wednesday as myself and Ricky and Daniel prayed for her, and Parker, as we prayed over her, we knew that God was doing something special. And on Friday, Cher stopped by the office, and she had a chance to connect with Pastor Sally and Pastor Katie and Patty in the office. And just the move of God that was so evident that was happening in that place. I just want to share. Would you just mind just raising your hand or just sharing that Cher is here this morning? What's amazing is, Fridays are my days off, but I got this text message from Pastor Sally, and it was actually a video of Cher saying thank you for what happened on Wednesday, and it actually, this video was an incredible testimony of what God is doing in her life. Now, listen. We are just being obedient as a church to go to the places where God is leading us. And so just knowing that that is happening, and Cher, we're glad you're here. We're glad you're here this morning. And God's got you. And at some point, we want to hear your testimony. We're going to hear your story. It's going to be awesome. Absolutely. So the prayer on location this week is Aurora. We are going to meet at the decadent restaurant known as Subway. So that way we're able to get in, to get fed, and then we're going to be dispersed out throughout the city. And again, it's all based on your comfort level. Everybody has an opportunity. Our kids have had an opportunity as well just to kind of be present and to pray with people. And we want to encourage you to just come and experience that. It's going to be awesome. So that's going to be happening at Aurora this week. Also, a couple other things coming up on the 11th of this month of August. Can you believe it's August already? There was this thing called summer. I don't remember where it went, but we're not done yet, so don't rush it. But it's already August, holy smokes. And on the 11th, we have a parent meeting that's going to be happening in the gym, and it is imperative. Parents, I want to make sure that you hear this. If you don't come to this meeting, you are going to be lost. You're not going to understand where children and youth ministry are going, and you're going to have to ask a lot of questions in order to get caught up. So it's imperative, if you are a parent of a child or youth, that you come to this meeting on the 11th. Things are changing. There is a shift that is occurring. There's big things that are going to be happening in youth and children's ministry, and we got to try to get everybody in one place to be able to communicate the information effectively at one time. So please make a plan to be there on the 11th. Here's the good news. It's right after church, so you don't have to go anywhere. And also, too, we're going to feed you. So that's pretty awesome. Yes, that's pretty awesome. So lunch is going to be provided. And then on the 25th, this is the last announcement for this morning. On the 25th coming up, I am pleased to announce to you that we are going to be launching this fall a young adult ministry. And it has been something that we have been praying over, and we have been seeking God's face and trying to do it the right way. So if you fall between the ages of 18 and 35, that's just our kind of rudimentary rubric for young adults. Just so everybody knows, I am not technically a young adult versus that paradigm. That's hard. That is not easy to hear, because I still feel very much like a young adult. In fact, the young adult group for our small group, which will start up as well at the end of August, is going to be meeting in Kaylee and I in our home, and we are excited to be able to host that with you all. It's going to be awesome. So we are having a kickoff event on the 25th following the service. It'll be right in the North Lawn, and we're going to cook out. We're going to have food. We're going to provide all of that. It's just going to be a really cool opportunity for you to hear what this is going to look like, what the young adult ministry is going to look like. Really cool things are planned. Great group of people that have started to really come together to put that all out there. So lots of really great things that are happening in the life of the church. We're glad you're here. We're glad you're here. God's got a word for you today, and I don't want you to miss that. I don't want you to miss his word for you today. Let's pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we come before you, and as we continue in worship through the receiving of your tithes and our offerings, Lord, may we be overwhelmed by your graciousness over us. Lord, may we also just give to you as according to your will, not ours, but Lord, what you have for us. And again, Jesus, we thank you for your presence. We pray that your Holy Spirit continues to reveal what it is that we need to hear from you today. Give us open ears. Give us open eyes. Help us to be attentive to your Spirit today. We pray this in your name. Amen.
No shadow, your light up, mountain, your climb up, come Your very body.
may be seated in preparation for communion this morning. I just have to tell you, man, singing these songs have really just hit me. The living hope that we have, the chains that are broken, the salvation that we experienced, and all because he didn't just conquer death. He conquered the grave. He didn't just conquer the cross. He conquered the grave. He went to the cross. He came and he took on flesh and became sin on our behalf. And not because he just needed something else to do. It's because out of desperation and great love for each and every one of us. To experience that love this morning. To experience the forgiveness that flows from the cross. In just a few minutes, we're going to participate in the receiving of communion. And we always intentionally do this on the first Sunday of the month and with our children here. Because we know that we want our children to not only experience communion, but to also potentially watch mom and dad experience communion. So communion is for anybody who has experienced this salvation. That you can say that I believe that Christ died for me. And that I am resurrected today with him. And I experience that joy that although maybe not every chain is broken, God is in the process of breaking chains in my life. And so even for our kids, mom and dad, if your children have gotten to the place where you know that they have accepted Christ as their Lord and Savior and they can communicate that to you, then we invite them to participate in communion with us. And if they're maybe not there yet, that's okay. That's okay. And maybe if you're not there yet, it's okay. Because God's got you. You're not here by accident. You're not here by accident. And so as we participate in communion this morning, let us remember, this is an act of remembrance, of that he is the chain breaker. And that it was through his death and through his resurrection that we can experience that freedom today. So as we sing this song, I pray that you would just prepare your hearts. I'm going to invite the ushers to come at this time.
Every night is holy day. shall come with trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, for this to stand before the throne. Christ
series with Acts and thinking about the early church and how it was being formed in its infancy. One of the things that they made priority was participating in communion together. It was, they actually had a full meal that they would participate in, and then they would always remember what Christ did for them. And this was a part of their not just tradition, because sometimes this can get lost in tradition, but it was something that was heart deep. It was that act of remembering that Christ went to the cross for them. So I pray this morning that as we participate in the receiving of these elements, that we are heart deep. That we are the weak that are made strong because of his life. That we are the forgiven because he is the forgiver. So the night that the disciples were together in the upper room, Jesus took that traditional Passover meal and he brought new life into it. He took the bread and after breaking it and giving thanks, he distributed it to the disciples. And in so doing was communicating to them, no matter what, I will always be there for you. That was the symbol of the passing out of the bread. No matter what, I will always be there for you. So let us take and eat in remembrance that Christ's body was broken for us. At the end of the meal, he took the cup of salvation. He reminded them that they're very familiar with the covenant of old and the covenant that God had made with Abraham in the desert. But this time, he took that cup and he says, "But I tell you, this is a new covenant forged in my blood." They didn't understand what it meant at that time, but then when they realized through his resurrected body, his blood purifies us from all unrighteousness. Not just some unrighteousness, but all unrighteousness. So let us take this cup and remember that this morning, that his blood purifies us from all unrighteousness. Take and drink. I'm going to invite Chris to come and to pray for us this morning.
Good morning, everybody. Death is defeated, the king is alive. I love that. Now watch this, Pastor. Exodus 14:13. But Moses told the people, "Don't be afraid. Just stand still and watch the Lord rescue you today. The Egyptians you see today will never be seen again. The Lord himself will fight for you. Just stay calm." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Why are you crying out to me? Tell the people to get moving." I think there's a message there, certainly for me. And I want to tell you a quick little story. I'm very thankful that I've been invited to pray, but I want to share something with you. About 2 months ago, Pastor said, "Hey, do you want to, you know, start praying in the worship service?" And I said, "Mm-mm, can't pray." And he's like, "What do you mean you can't pray?" I said, when I get up in front of the congregation, I have so many things that I want to pray for that I kind of freeze up. And then something happened after that. As some of you know, I'm in classes for pastoral ministry. Shame set in. There was a voice in my head, and this is true. It went something like this. "You know, some pastor you're going to be. You can't even pray for your congregation, and you'll never be a good pastor." This is absolutely true. Now, who do you think was in my head? Okay? And you know what? I've been talking with Pastor about some other things, and all I know is that, you know, if I'm courageous for God, the rest will take care of itself. No more shame, you know? I'm not dealing with that. We're going to give a voice to shame, and I'm going to take that out of the darkness and bring light to it. So, anyway, thank you. Thank you. Here we go. If I freeze up, give me grace, please. We have a lot to pray for. Gracious Heavenly Father, we want to say thank you for your healing hand with Bob Carlton. He's doing much better. He's still in the hospital, but it's been a miraculous turnaround. Another miracle. And then also, sadly, we had two mass shootings, one yesterday in El Paso, Texas, and another one early this morning in Dayton, Ohio. And we just ask for your healing hand in those areas and help to put an end to this violence. We're truly lost without you, Lord. And we just ask that you be with the families that are certainly hurting right now. We also want to pray for some of our local churches. One is in Knox, the Knox Presbyterian Church. They are in transition with a new pastor and looking for a pastor. And also, we want to pray for the Milford Church of the Nazarene and their new pastor. We also want to pray for our missionaries all around the world, Emily and Danilo Aguilar, who are serving in the Western Mediterranean. And Lord, I just want to thank you so much for many, many people in this church. I want to say thank you so much for my friend Pastor Sally and the things she's doing with children's ministry, my friend Pastor Katie and all the wonderful things that she's doing with youth ministry. And thank you for Daniel Heath and the band, Monty, Amy, Cindy, and Cindy, the guitar player whose name I don't know yet, and Joseph on bass and Daniel Kwok on drums. Thank you so much for everyone in this wonderful church that we have to worship in. And Lord Jesus, in your heavenly name we pray. Amen.
Sorry about that. So growing up, unfortunately, I had a problem with lying. I lied a lot. In fact, I lied so much that I started to believe my lies as true. That's how often I lied. And I'm not proud of this. I mean, I stand up here confessionally to you that Satan had planted a seed of lying in my heart. It was awful. It was awful. And to the extent, one time, a lie that went really, really far. In fifth grade, most fifth grade teachers, if you had a failing grade on a test, you had to take it home and have it signed by your parents. So every time I had a failing grade, which unfortunately was quite often, because I struggled with a learning disability, and it wasn't tracked and dealt with properly until till later. Actually, by fifth grade, I was getting the help that I needed, but it still made learning difficult. And so in the midst of all of that, I had all these failing grades, and in my home growing up, when you brought home a failing grade, you had consequences. And it just so happened that my dad's 42-inch leather belt's nickname was Consequence. And so there were definitely times and that I met consequence. And it was actually, I still to this day will tell you that it was the absolute best thing that I needed. And that, you know, it was one of those moments, you've heard me share this before, where there were times when my dad would say, "I love you," in the midst of that. And you know, and he would say, you know, "This hurts me more than it hurts you." And to which one time I said, "Well, then let's switch places." And that didn't go over well for some reason. So this was a problem, and I got another failing grade that came home, and I was mortified, and I thought, there's no way I'm going to show this to my parents. There's just no way. So what I did was, by fifth grade, I became a master at signing my mom's signature. I was really, really good at it. So I actually signed my mom's signature on the test. Now, I will tell you that the Holy Spirit, which convinces us and convicts us of sin, was in full force that day because the conviction was heavy. I mean, I was feeling so convicted. I was like, I can't do this. This is wrong. In fact, I'm actually starting to kind of shake a little bit, remembering that conviction that I experienced. And so I erased the signature on the test. But the problem was I didn't erase it fully. And there was remnants of my mom's signature. And then I couldn't take it to her and say, "Hey, could you sign this?" Because she would have been like, "I already did." And but you could sign it a little heavier this time, maybe, you know. And I was like, "No, I'm just going to accept the consequence." I took the test back to the teacher. And the teacher looked at it and was like, something's not right here. And so being a good teacher, she did her homework, and she sent the test back and said to my mom, "Hey, there's a test coming home. I need you to sign and send back to me." She's like, "No problem." So all of a sudden, she gets the test. She looks at it, and she goes, "Stephen, I don't understand. I signed this." And I was like, "I know. I don't know." You know, and I just lied. I just lied in that moment. It was awful. And it was also, the signature was so good that she literally thought that she had signed it. That's besides the point. But in those moments, I realized that I had a very big issue with lying. And that day, I met Consequences Friends. You know Consequences Friends? You know, reminder, reprimand, admonish. Met them all that day. So a story today has a time and it has at times been misrepresented as a story about money. But what you're actually going to find as we look into the story today found in Acts chapter 5 is that this story is about two more critical things rather than money. It's about lying and it's about pride. Over the last several weeks, we've been putting a huge emphasis on calling and mission. What is the call that God has placed in our lives, and where am I going to find places to serve or places to start ministry, places to go? And I think that the early stage of the church, when it was in its early infancy stage of development, they too had times where they had to stop and they had to ask this critical question: what are my motives for serving and giving? What are my motives for serving and giving? And I think it's really good for us to stop here and to pause in this series as we talk about being a sent people to ask ourselves the challenging question: what's my motivation? What is my motivation to be sent? What is my motivation to serve? What is my motivation to potentially start new ministries? Am I starting a new ministry, or am I doing something? Am I stepping out in faith because this is what God has called me to? Or is this because this is what I have called myself to and I've named it God? And so as we pause, we're going to look here in Acts chapter 5, and we're going to see that there is this incredible story that when we get to the root and the heart of the story, there's a lot of stuff going on here. So if you're turning to Acts chapter 5, and if you're using the Pew Bibles, the red Bible in front of you is going to be on page 984. You'll find Acts 5 on 984. And then if you are using the yellow Bible, it's going to be on page 833. Now, I love sharing this with you, but the Bibles and the pews in front of you are gifts. We purchased those on purpose so that you will take those with you. So if you need a Bible or if you know somebody who needs a Bible, please take that Bible with you. The cool thing is to walk around and to see people actually walking around with their Bible, and it's a red or a yellow Bible. And we love that. So it's really, really cool. So as we turn to Acts chapter 5, we actually have to begin at the end of chapter 4 in order to get context to what's happening here in the scripture. Verse 32 of chapter 4 reads, "All the believers were united in heart and mind, and they felt that what they owned was not their own, so they shared everything that they had. The apostles testified powerfully to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and God's great blessing was upon them all. There was no needy people among them, because those who owned land or houses would sell them and bring the money to the apostles to give to those in need. For instance, there was Joseph, the one of the apostles nicknamed Barnabas, which means son of encouragement. He was from the tribe of Levi and came from the island of Cyprus. He sold a field and he sold a field that he owned and brought the money to the apostles." Now, typically, this is the point in the message where everybody starts freaking out. Because this is like, you think to yourself, oh no, it's a sell everything sermon. It's a get rid of my house, and it's sell it all, give it all to the poor and the needy. Now, church, listen to me. That is actually not what this story is about. But I will tell you this. If God does put it on your heart to do that, boy, you better follow through. Because that's exactly what's going on here in the beginning of this story when we look at Acts chapter 4, the end of 4. If you look at verse 32, there is an emphasis that's here. Look at this, united in heart and mind. They were united together in heart and mind, and they felt that what they owned was not their own. And so because of that feeling, because of being united in heart and mind, because I'm assuming as we read into the scripture that they were listening to what God was placing on their heart to do, they sold their houses, they sold their land, they sold what they possessed, and they gave it to those in need. But I want to make sure that we hear this morning. God did not tell them they had to do this. This was a free will offering. And I don't share that as kind of a get out of jail free card. You know, you're like, whew, I get a pass. I don't have to sell everything and give it to the poor. Because there are plenty of other places where the challenge is for us to give sacrificially and to take care of those who are poor and needy around us. And so we have to listen to what God has placed on our heart. But it makes the what we're going to read in Acts chapter 5 that much more important. In Acts chapter 5, starting at verse 1, it says, "But there was a certain man named Ananias, who, with his wife Sapphira, sold some property. He brought part of the money to the apostles." Now, if we stop there, this is an awesome story. If we stopped right here, this is a great story. Ananias and Sapphira, they had some land, they sold it, and they brought part of the money to the apostles. Yes! Right? Because that's really great. But then it takes a turn. Unfortunately, they claimed that it was the full amount. With his wife's consent, he kept the rest. Now, scholars agree that there is a direct connection to the actions of Ananias and Sapphira up to Barnabas and the end of chapter 4 and the accolades and the accomplishments that Barnabas was getting. And Ananias and Sapphira wanted to experience the same. They wanted the big pat on the back. And what's happening here is that it's not just the sin of lying, but it's the sin of pride. You see, Ananias and Sapphira, they wanted to give a little, but they wanted to get credit for a lot. That's really what's happening here in this story. Now, earlier I said that this story is not about money. And we can ask the question, well, how? How do we know, or why would you think that it's not about money? Well, replace the object in the story. So in this case, the land that was sold and the money that was earned. Replace that with fruit or livestock. When we do that, we see that it's not about the gift. It's about the heart of the giver. And when we look, it helps us to understand that it's the reason why Abel's gift was received, but Cain's was not. You got to go back all the way to Genesis chapter 4 and to see that Cain brought some while Abel brought the best portion that he had, and it was his first fruits. He didn't bring finances to God, and he brought his best fruit, his first fruits. And again, it helps us to realize and understand that it's not about the object that's given, it's about the heart that it's given with. In fact, Proverbs 15:8 reads, "The Lord detests the sacrifice of the wicked." Think about that. The Lord detests the sacrifice of the wicked. So we keep reading, verse 3. Then Peter said, "Ananias, why have you let Satan fill your heart?" Now, the word heart here in the Greek is cardia. It's where we get our English word for cardiovascular or cardio regarding our heart. And in fact, in the Jewish context and in the writing of this time, the heart was actually the center of not just the physical health, but spiritual health as well. It was the seat of thoughts, passions, desires, appetites, affections, purposes, even endeavors. They believed that all of that was birthed out of a person's heart. So the challenging question that Peter gives to Ananias is, why have you let Satan fill that part of your life, your heart? In the end, again, it was a heart issue. Keep reading in 3. You lied to the Holy Spirit and you kept some of the money for yourself. So here's the amazing thing. Peter rightly points out who Ananias lied to. He didn't lie to the church. He didn't lie to Peter. I mean, yeah, he did. He got to the place where, yes, it was a lie that was perpetrated to Peter and to the church. But ultimately, Peter is pointing him, saying, listen, you can lie to me until you're blue in the face. And there's going to be points where I'm not even going to know. But you're not lying to me. You're lying to God. And that's important. Verse 4, the property was yours to sell or not sell as you wished. And after selling it, the money was also yours to give away. So basically, Peter's saying, there was no reason to lie. It was yours. You sold a property and you could give as much as you want or as little as you want. It was completely up to you. So the only reason that we understand that Ananias and Sapphira lied was because they were trying to build themselves up and they were trying to show everybody, look how great they were. That's a dangerous place to live, people. That is a dangerous place to live. What Peter says next cuts to the heart again. How could you do this thing like this? Do a thing like this. You weren't lying to us, but to God. Think about that phrase. How could you do a thing like this? I love actually in the original King James and looking at the New King James Version, the phrasing there is actually a great Greek phrase. It's, why have you conceived this thing in your heart? Why have you conceived this thing in your heart? Now I want to stop here for a moment. Just as I talked about the story not being about money and really talking about lying and pride, those are all two things that did happen, but it's the root of how we got to the lying and the pride. And when you get to the root, you have to address and you have to identify the sin. Ultimately, it was sin that was leading Ananias and Sapphira. And it's sin that was conceived in their heart. We know that this was premeditated because in verse 2 of chapter 5, it says, with his wife's consent. Now listen, we don't know anything about Ananias and Sapphira's marriage. We don't know if they had a great marriage, a terrible marriage, but we can tell you that they agreed on this. They both agreed, hey, listen, let's sell some property. We'll give some of the money. We'll tell them it's all the money and we'll get all the praise. We know that they agreed on that. But this word conceived is really important. It's really important because it actually, like I mentioned earlier, there's a great Greek phrase called tithemi. tithemi. The word tithemi means to lay down or to take a horizontal position. So I want you to think about this in light of what we just read. Why have you laid down with this thing in your heart? Why have you taken a horizontal position with this thing in your heart? To take it even step further, I want you to think about this. It's as if Peter is saying, why have you gotten into bed with sin? The imagery is powerful. Laying down with sin. I mean, laying down with somebody is intimate. We could probably agree with that. I'll give you an example. A few years ago, Kaylee and I were looking for a new mattress. We were tired of sleeping in a canoe. And actually, that kind of sounds funny now that I just told the canoe story a few weeks ago. So we were tired of sleeping in a taco. And so we were like, we have to go out and we have to do some mattress shopping. And we like read online or we heard from somebody that you have to lay on a mattress for 15 minutes before you can determine if it's good or not. So here we are traveling around the area to every mattress store, and if we found a mattress that we were like potentially gonna, you know, purchase or even just into, we would lay on this thing for 15 minutes. Folks, it is awkward laying on a mattress for 15 minutes in public with your spouse. I'm just gonna put that out there. Even more awkward was what happened at IKEA when I thought Kaylee was laying next to me trying out this mattress, and all of a sudden I look over and there's this dude just laying there. And then all of a sudden he slowly turns his head over to me with this grin. I was like, oh, no, no, no. So I got up real fast in that moment. But think about this. Laying down next to somebody or something is intimate. And Peter is telling Ananias, you have laid down with sin, and it is conceived in your heart. James 1:15 says, these desires. Now, when James is mentioning these desires, he's mentioning our own desires here. He's saying that our own desires give birth to sinful actions. And when sin is allowed to grow, it gives birth to death. I mean, just think about that in light of this conversation about conception, about laying down, and when sin is allowed to grow, it does give birth eventually, but what it gives birth to is death. So, in this case, the sin of lying is what was fully grown in Ananias, and then we'll soon see in Sapphira. For Ananias and Sapphira, this was a secret sin up until the point when Peter called them out. But it was a secret sin. But I always want you to remember that a secret sin on earth is always an open scandal to God. We have a saying in my home, God knows. God knows. You know, I trust my kids. I love my kids. And I have to take them sometimes at their word. And there are times when we just have to say, you know what? God knows. God knows. Because we can't play hide and seek with the one who created the universe. And we can't think that our sin is just in secret. When just like the, you know, a secret sin on earth, it's an open scandal to God. And the sin for Ananias here, of course, is greed. But the greater sin is pride. And this sin imitates itself in many ways for us today. I mean, we sometimes give the impression that we're holier than we are. We give the impression that we read our Bibles and we pray every day, and the reality is sometimes that's just not true. Or sometimes we give the impression that we have it all together, when in truth, we don't have it all together. And so even in those moments, we just kind of lie about it. People say, how are you? Fine. Right? We exaggerate our spiritual accomplishments because we're afraid sometimes if people see the truth, they're not going to like what they see. Man, I wish we can get to the place where we stop caring about what other people thought and we cared more about what God thought. And we trusted the relationships that we have with the people around us, that when even when we are truthful and even when it does hurt and we tell the truth, that God's got us. That God's got us. Their sin was rooted in pride. And let me tell you this. The sin of pride corrupts the church more quickly than anything else. It's when pride gets in the way. In other places in Scripture, we understand that it's actually pride that causes conflict among the believers. Pride is what can stand in the way of the greatest days of the church, because the church is unwilling to be humble. We keep reading in verse 5. As soon as Ananias heard these words, he fell to the floor and died. Everyone who heard about it was terrified. Now, wait a minute. I thought that this was the New Testament God, right? I thought that that sounds very Old Testament God, doesn't it? That sounds like what? This bro just sinned and lied and you just dropped him dead right there? Like, that doesn't sound right. You know what? What we read in Scripture is that God is an unchanging God. He's not wishy-washy when it comes to sin. God is holy. He can have nothing to do with sin. And in that holiness, he holds us to the accountability that he does, whether it's Old Testament or New Testament. God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And the purity of the church was his highest priority. The purity of the church was his highest priority. He hates sin. And when we look at Ananias, we see that it wasn't somebody who knew better or didn't know better. We see somebody who was a believer that was cutting corners. Somebody who shouldn't have done what he did, but he did. And it's important to also recognize that Peter wasn't the one who killed him. It was God. God was the one that killed him in that moment. Verse 6, then some young men got up, wrapped him in a sheet, and took him out and buried him. About 3 hours later, his wife came in, not knowing what had happened. Peter asked her, was this the price that you and your husband received for your land? What a generous question. Peter gave her the opportunity to tell the truth. He gave her the opportunity. He says, is this how much you paid for this land? She had a choice in that moment. And it was her choice to make. And she said, yes, that was the price. Oh, man. I so wish in that moment that this story would have gone differently. I so wish in that moment that maybe even Peter wouldn't have asked her. Maybe Peter would have given her a heads up. And he would have said, hey, listen, your husband is dead, and it was because he lied about the price of the land. So tell me, is this how much you paid for the land? But the reason why it didn't go down that way is because ultimately it was her choice whether she was going to tell the truth or she was going to lie. And ultimately, even bigger than that, the bigger picture here is that Peter could not confess her sin. And even bigger than that, is that you can't confess someone else's sin. At the end of the day, the only sin that you can confess is your own. You can intercede on behalf, you can pray for, but at the end of the day, when it comes to dealing with the sin in our lives, the sin of our hearts, the sin between us and God, it is confessed between us and God, and no one else can confess to that. Verse 9, Peter said, how could the two of you even think of conspiring to test the Spirit of the Lord like this? The young men who buried your husband are just outside the door, and they will carry you out too. Instantly, she fell to the floor and died. When the young men came in and saw that she was dead, they carried her out and buried her beside her husband. I'm sure these guys are probably tired, right? They walk back in, they're like, oh, geez, there's another one. Oh, wrap her up, take her out too. But in that moment, judgment was declared. Great fear gripped the entire church and everyone else who heard what had happened. I'm sure that great fear gripped the church. And I'm sure that great fear was an incredible teacher of how not to live, or is an incredible teacher of what not to do. And I'm sure that they were listening intently, and I'm sure that they realized, wow, wait a minute, this God means business. He's not messing around. We just can't go willy-nilly with this thing called sin. We just can't pretend like it, like there's a sin that's better than others. That we have to realize that God loves us enough to purify us, not just from some of our unrighteousness, but all of our unrighteousness. The purity of the church was God's highest priority. And the advancement of the kingdom rested on the integrity of the church and its missionaries. And in that moment, as this young church was coming into its own, God was saying, I'm going to protect the integrity of my bride. The same is true today. God will only trust us as individuals, and trust us as a church with bigger things. He will only trust us with bigger things when we've proven that we can handle the smaller things well. I want you to think about this as we close. High school teams a lot of times have players that take the play into the quarterback. You know, from the coach will whisper the play into the player's ear, and then the player runs out into the huddle, and he communicates the play. And all of a sudden, they go out and they execute the play. Well, what if the coach says, hey, I want you to run, you know, Z45, 9 dive, you know, 3. I just made that up. It's probably a play somewhere at some time. And so all of a sudden, the running back or the person that's taking the play in, they go out there and they give him, so that's a run play, and he makes it a pass play. So all of a sudden, they pass the ball. And the coach goes, well, maybe that was, I don't know what's going on there. Maybe that was, so he sends the player out again. He says, hey, this is the play I want you to run. So he runs out there. And again, it's wrong because the player is just choosing what they want to do. What do you think is going to happen between the relationship of the coach to the player? The coach is going to stop using that player. The coach is not going to trust that the player can take that play into the field. Because the player just keeps lying and saying, no, that's not what we're supposed to do. Church, the story for us this morning, as kind of odd as it is for me to preach, to be honest with you, is for us to learn what not to do, to learn, God, how do you want us to live, to recognize that whether our sin is public or secret, it's still sin, and God loves us enough not to leave us in that condition. And it's to realize that he's not going to trust us with bigger things if he can't trust us to handle the smaller things well. This is where we're at. We need to stop. We need to pause. We need to say, God, search my heart. What's my motivation? What am I doing? Why am I doing it this way? Why is it like this? Help me, Lord, to see the path before me. Would you stand as we close? As we're in this series and we're reading through the book of Acts, and in preparation for next week, I encourage you to read chapters 6 through 8. So this week, read 6 through 8. We've been reading one chapter a week, but we're going to kind of move through chapters 6 through 8. And so I encourage you to do that this week. And I encourage you to listen what God had for you today. What does he have for you today? What is he speaking into you regarding the message this morning? And as we do traditionally, as we close in prayer, I just encourage you to hold out and extend your hands to receive this blessing, this benediction over you and this benediction over your week. Let's pray together. Gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, I come before you and I'm thankful that you love us enough to address the secret sins or even the public sins in our lives. Lord, that you hate sin. You don't want it to control us. You don't want it to be the answer to our lives. And Lord, we desperately want to protect the integrity of our heart. We want to protect the integrity of our church. We want to protect the integrity of our families. And so, Lord, whatever the challenge was for us this morning, I pray that you would have your way in us. Lord, seek our hearts. Find any wicked way in us today, Lord. And maybe this morning you're hearing this and you say, you know, I can't confess someone else's sin, but I need to be able to confess my own. And so if that's you this morning, I just pray in your heart that you would just be confessing that out to God. He's listening and he's here. He wants to take and receive that. He doesn't want you. We weren't designed to carry the load of that this morning. And I pray that you would receive freedom and victory and forgiveness this morning. And so, church, as we conclude our service, I just pray that you would join me in saying this benediction as we pray. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, amen and amen. You are sent.